Hey, I'm going to talk about kleptomania and eating disorders again today. And I say again because I've spoken about it quite a lot. And the reason I'm talking about it again is because I was listening to the Women's Hour podcast this morning, and they were going on about kleptomania, not necessarily specific to eating disorders or in relation to eating disorders, but they're talking about kleptomania and they were talking about the difference between kleptomania and somebody who steals shit. So someone who steals shit for sort of profit, you know, someone who, the example that they gave was somebody who steals perfume from a store so that they can sell it on eBay or something or online and make a profit. That's really different from kleptomania, which is a compulsion to steal. And so what it feels like is you go into a store and you just feel this overwhelming desire to take something, and it builds up and it builds up, and you might fight it, and then you get this, you can't fight it anymore, you take something, you then sort of feel a thrill if you get out the store and you get away with it, and then after that you feel like absolute shit because you just stole something. A lot of the time people with kleptomania will take things that they won't use, might even return them to the store because of those guilt feelings. So it's really more like a real compulsion, a compulsion that feels uncontrollable. And it's such a strange thing to say, because when I say a compulsion that feels uncontrollable, that's really what it feels like. And that's hard to understand if you haven't done it and or had it or had that. And I find it hard to understand now. So I'm listening to this podcast about this, they had the woman on, she was 50 years old, had kleptomania since 8 years old, been stealing almost every day of her life for that long, and she's just saying, you know, it's a compulsion, I can't control it. And I'm sitting there, and even me, who has had that compulsion when I had an eating disorder, I had kleptomania with my eating disorder, I've had that compulsion, and even me sitting there is like, oh, you can stop. You can control a compulsion, can't you? But I know that you can't, because I had it and I tried and I couldn't. So it's just, if you haven't, even if you have had it and you overcome it and it was 15 or plus years ago, which it was for me, it's hard to really understand it. So if you haven't had it at all, of course people aren't going to understand it, and they're just going to think, you know, of course, that's something you can control. I promise it's not. Anyhow, so as I just said, I had kleptomania when I had anorexia, when I had an eating disorder. It started about 3 or 4 years into my eating disorder. And it absolutely was an uncontrollable compulsion. I can't say that I did it every day, because I didn't, but I didn't go, well, I might have taken something teeny tiny every day, like stolen toilet roll from the university bathrooms, things like that. I did stuff like that. Most of the things that I took were very, very low value. Here's the weird thing. I used to go to the discounted section of the supermarket. You know, the part where they've got stuff that's going out of date and it's all really cheap. And I'd steal from there. My issue was not being able to afford it. I absolutely could. But I'd had an eating disorder for long enough that my brain perceived that there was resource scarcity. And the thing that I liked about the podcast that I listened to is they talked about resource scarcity as being the reason for the compulsion. And that, absolutely, I agree with, because I never stole a thing before I had an eating disorder. 4 years into an eating disorder and 4 years in of me presenting my brain with the perception of resource scarcity by not eating enough food, when resources are scarce, food would usually be the first thing that would be scarce, evolutionary-wise, I would imagine. And then I developed this uncontrollable compulsion where I would just take small, usually meaningless, inexpensive things. I often would not use them. I would often put them in my room and try and hide them or give them to somebody. Or sometimes I would take them back to the store. It's a lot of effort, isn't it? Go into a store, loiter around the discounted vegetables area, steal a moldy apple or something, feel really bad about it, come back, and then have to somehow return said mouldy apple without anyone seeing. It was a lot of effort, honestly. Fuck's sake. Eating disorders are mental. Anyway, so, yeah, did it. A lot. And I think it's... I do think it's important to talk about. I've said why before as well. I think it's important to talk about because when I had kleptomania with my eating disorder, I thought I was the worst person in the world. I thought, what sort of disgusting, awful person does this sort of thing? Turns out it wasn't me. It was me with my brain in apocalypse mode, thinking that there's scarce resources and desperate times call for desperate measures. It turns out I fully recover and the urge completely went away. I have not touched a thing that I haven't bought since I fully recovered from my eating disorder. And that is really welcome news, I know, for those of you that suffer from this, hate the fact that you suffer from it, can't talk about it, won't talk about it. That is what I want you to know. You get fully recovered, and I mean fully recovered, from your eating disorder. It goes away. And that is a wonderful, wonderful thing. And I say can't talk about it, won't talk about it. I fully understand why people don't talk about it. I have had a handful of clients, well, maybe more than a handful, that have admitted to me kleptomania and asked for help with it. I've had a large number of clients that after they've got recovered have admitted that kleptomania was an issue, but at the time they could not bring themselves to talk to even me about it. And I'm someone that has openly admitted that I had this when I had an eating disorder. I've written about it. It's in all my books. It's on all the blogs. It's in YouTube videos. So I'm, you know, they know I get it, but they don't want to talk to me, even me, about it. And the reason for that is I understand this as well. If you don't ever tell anyone about something, it's really unlikely that it's going to get out. If you tell somebody anything, that increases the chances that that is going to get out. And it is something that people are deeply ashamed of. And that is absolutely the reason that I never told anybody about it either. So I get that too. I wish that it wasn't something that had carried so much shame. Of course, it's a sort of ugly thing, isn't it? It's nasty. No one wants to... No one can sit there and say, well, that's a nice thing to do on any way, shape or form. Somebody suffers from it. Shopkeepers suffer. Everybody suffers, really, because often the price of goods goes up because of shoplifting. But I guess, in a sense, that's just life, isn't it? There are shit things, there are shit elements, there are shit side effects, and not talking about it and pretending it's not a thing doesn't help. The more that we can talk about things, the more we can sort of try and understand why is somebody's brain compelling them to do that, the more we can actually then work out, oh, it's happening because of X, Y, Z. And when we work that out, it makes sense. Like when I was able to work out the reason that my brain feels that compulsion to take things is because my brain believes that we are in a apocalyptic environment where resources are scarce. And the reason that my brain believes that is because I have presented it with that environment by restricting food for God knows however many years. That is how I presented that environment of resource scarcity to my brain. And my brain is reacting accordingly. It's not even reacting weirdly. If you think about it from the brain's point of view, scarce resources, everybody for themselves, dog eat dog world out there, got to sort it out. It would be a trait that would aid your survival in such an environment. And so when we can look at it from that perspective, we can have compassion for the brain and be like, oh, my brain's just trying to keep me surviving. Oh, nice brain. Thank you, brain. Thanks very much. How do I get out of this? How do I get that to switch off? Oh, I guess I would have to stop presenting my brain with an environment of resource scarcity. I guess that's what I'd have to do in order to turn off that switch. And I'm going to say it again, because that's really what I'm here to tell you. Those of you that suffer with kleptomania and with an eating disorder, the switch can get turned off. You got to really convince your brain that you are not in an environment of resource scarcity. And that's what recovery will do. If you get yourself fully recovered, that will solve that problem and it will go away. Okay, bye.